to look at you instead of the camera?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm Hanna Kemp. I'm the director of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe at Perry Players Community Theater. Narnia, always been a big part of my life. Okay, so I was about 5 when the movie came out, the first movie, big Disney movie. Saw it in theaters, got obsessed, we got the DVD, watched it all the time. 9th birthday, had a Narnia-themed birthday party, and I had about 3 different outfits that I changed into because I wanted to look like Lucy. And then years later, I find Levi Sheldon. He's also a fan of Narnia. We hit it off. He becomes my partner in crime. It was another dream entirely to want to do a play in the beginning when I started doing theater when I was about 10, 12, because I really admired the director that I started with here at Perry Players in the sense that he really pushed for professionalism, even though we were all a bunch of random people from the community. He really pushed, and he had his hand in every single aspect of theater. So he put his heart and soul into it, and so I thought that was really cool, and I didn't think I'd ever actually get to do it. But fast forward to 2020, the year of COVID, the theater no longer had a director in place for their show Christmas Carol. So I was only 18 at the time, but I saw it as kind of an opportunity. I'd done the show a few times, so I knew it really well. So that was kind of my chance to step in. So that was dream come true number one, was directing a play at Perry Players. And so I did, let's see, one more after that. And then Narnia was going to be my third. Narnia, I proposed it to the board of governors here at Perry Players to see if they would be interested. They were, but I don't think they had any idea about how big of an undertaking it was going to be. Granted, nor did I.
With working with Hanna, how did everything play out?
She's an It was great. I think I tell her this enough, so it's probably not good for her to hear it again, but I do think she's probably one of the most talented people I've ever met. Months ahead of time, we were planning everything out. We were planning what scripts we were going to use. We were planning the costumes. We were talking about the puppets ages ago, the lion puppet especially, because we knew immediately that that's what we wanted to do.
Okay, so I knew Aslan would be our icon from the beginning. I came across a picture of the lion puppet at the 360 Theater, I believe it's called. They're not the only ones who did the lion puppet, but I think theirs was the one I modeled it after the most. Came across the picture, I was dead set immediately. I was like, I don't know how we're gonna do this, but we are. And I showed it to my parents, and they said the same thing. I don't know how we're gonna do this, but we have to. Seeing this now, we have to shoot for the stars with Aslan. So ever since we had this lion pup in mind, we knew he was going to be our icon, our figure for the show. He was our big reveal on social media. It was as soon as we finished the lion puppet, we were super excited for people to see him. And behold, once we opened, lots of people's favorite part of the show was just seeing Aslan come out for the first time.
It's just plywood and bolts, basically. I drew out a form on paper. There's no instructions, there's no experience or anything like that. It's just
no tutorial.
An idea. I think I printed out a picture of a lion. I took some measurements of what a normal lion should be, and then I figured out how big a 12-foot lion should be. And I drew that on a large piece of paper on the wall. And just started doing a little bit of math to figure out dimensions of the feet and the legs and how far the head should be away from his shoulders and the tail and things of that nature. And
yeah, it was a lot more complex once we started getting into it. It's not just like make legs, make a body and feet. It had to look proportionally.
Right? It had to move proportionally. I think my biggest thought as I was building this was, how is this going to move? And we watched videos on the movement of lions and things that, and I just wanted to make sure that we put the joints in the right place, like God intended. So when a 12-foot lion walked on stage, that he would move fluidly.
You know? Yeah, you had to figure out the best way to, or the easiest way to, like, when you lift up a foot, how is like the paw going to like do this motion and then sit back down on the floor?
Yeah, you don't want him.
Yeah, because I think for a while he was walking on his ankles.
And you know, when you pick the foot up naturally, it tends to come and land like that, so.
I think when we actually brought the lion out on stage, there was this kind of, okay, we're going to have to really redo blocking here, because all of a sudden there's this 8-foot, you know, 12-foot long lion that is just dominating the entire stage. How do you not be overwhelmed by that in terms of diminishing every other character that's there, and at the same time working around it, physically moving around the lion? So yeah, there was, but apart from that, no, everything kind of turned out as I expected.
I think the most challenging part specifically was the Aslan face, because it was supposed to look like bark, and so just coming up with different textures and things like that, just kind of coming up with things on the fly and in a short time frame, that to me was challenging. It was fun, but it was still challenging.
For the record, let it be known, building Aslan was the hardest.
Yes.
Yeah? In agreement?
It was so much fun.
Building Aslan was the hardest project of the show, for sure.
That was amazing.
That was awesome.
I cannot. That was
I was
good.
Like, wait, how are they building that? Mm-hmm. Like, the first night I saw the body, I was like, how did they do that?
I was very impressed, because I thought it was going to be more like a cloth. Yeah. You know, knit that.
So it's cool you guys got to work with a giant puppet.
Yeah.
Yes.
As
yeah.
the leads next to him.
It was actually really interesting because you get more people to play off of. Like, we have Rob, but we also have Corey doing the head and all the other people working the body and all this other stuff. So you have choices as to who you're going to react with. And as we went through the scenes more and more, you kind of pick when and where you'd look at Rob. Yeah.
I never go into a show like expecting like something magical and, you know, bewildering. So when my director was talking about, you know, we're gonna have a like an 8-foot tall lion puppet, and we're gonna have snow, and we're gonna have all these mythical creatures roam around on stage, and a full soundtrack and putting that together in roughly a month's time. No. We're not doing that. And then it happened. It did. We brought it together. And so that surprised me more than anything.
And then when you saw the lion. Enormity, the magnitude of that lion, and when it came out, and the gasp from the audience was incredible.
Whenever Aslan first comes out, it is such a beautiful moment. The music really helps to add that little sprinkles on top of the cupcake moment. It was just a big, beautiful moment. Then see Rob looking beautiful as ever, just come out, just look out in the crowd, and you're like, Aslan.
But the first time Aslan came out, and you're just like, holy cow, there's this gigantic puppet. And all the puppets were really impressive, and I think that's the thing that kind of blew me away was Aslan and his entrance and Rob's work with the voice acting and the physical acting as well. He did such a great job with that. I think that was probably what surprised me the most.
Casting the show was really fun, really interesting. I didn't think it would be all that fun and interesting, even though I love casting shows, but I really did go into it with a semi-idea of how I wanted it to go.
What were you feeling at auditions?
Oh my God.
Nervous and anxious. I was definitely feeling great because I had already gotten down the British accent, which I had been speaking for like a million years, what it seemed like.
You were really smiley at auditions. Like, was there any fear in you at all? Were you a little intimidated? Nope, you were just having fun.
I was like, it's fun.
Yeah, thing to note, Adele has no fear.
No, she doesn't.
What about?
Well, at auditions, I was feeling really nervous. Like, I had no idea who any of the people were. I just, like, went with it. Because I've seen the movie, like, a bunch of times, so...
Helped.
Yeah.
I was trembling the entire time, but...
Well, did you expect to get the part?
I didn't. I knew I had a relatively good British accent. Apparently it was better than I thought it was.
I mean, anytime you go into auditions, it's just nerve-wracking for me. I always shake holding a piece of paper in front of my face, you know, trying to give as much as I can, but I had fun.
You were here, weren't you? You made Lucy out to be a liar of all the poisons.
I didn't think that!
You didn't think at all! I guess that says it all, I suppose.
Let me just say, it wound up completely different than I thought it would be. Every single character I think I had in mind wound up being completely different than I envisioned, and way better than I envisioned. The people, I had a ton of people show up. The auditions for this thing was insane. This is a straight play. Normally straight plays get like 30 people max to show up to the entire audition process. It's normally the musicals that pull in a lot. This was probably one of the biggest audition turnouts that this theater has had in a long time, musical or not.
I was feeling nervous because I really wanted to be in part of the cast because Narnia is, I mean, read the books growing up, loved the movie, and British accent right up my alley.
For me, it was nerve-wracking because I'm standing up in front of people I know, and there's a lot of people I don't know. And the directors didn't do a great job of making me feel like they were enjoying my performance when we did it. So it was a bit nerve-wracking in that aspect.
And I was not expecting to get as big of a role as I did if I did get accepted, because everyone they had audition for The White Witch was way older than me. And so then we got the cast list and I was like, oh, I was not expecting that. So it was just like mostly, I think, indifference at auditions, but like afterward, when we got the cast list, it was more of like, oh, okay, all right, this is happening.
I was hoping that I would get a role that my grandchildren could see me on stage. That's the bottom line truth.
The auditions were the most fun I've ever had at an audition. I was thinking, look at the fun these people are having. The whole thing was like a big party.
the auditions. There was no stress at all, unlike most auditions. And then that experience carried all the way through to the end of the last night.
The auditions were difficult because I always get panicky during them. Always get panicky. And one of the things that's difficult to portray when you're panicky on stage is calmness and authority and gravitas might be the word.
When the cast notification first came out, I was in my room, like, doing my homework, and my dad rushed into my room and said, "Look at the list, your name is on it." I'm like, "For what?" And then I was like, "What list?" And then I looked on it and it said Perry Players, and I was like, "Dad, I'm so excited."
I cast the show, but there was a previous show still happening. And so when it came time to rehearse after casting, we had nowhere to go. I tried getting in touch with some local churches, but I was also kind of picky with where I wanted my cast to be and like how much freedom we would have. So honestly, I'd say most of our rehearsals started out in the lobby over there, which is, it isn't small, but it is small. It's about half the size of the stage. So every blocking session that we did was very compact. So my actors were troopers in the sense that they had to kind of visualize what I meant by the staging and then transfer it onto the stage and make it work, and it kind of click in their brain. Like, oh, it's not like 2 feet apart. It's actually 10 feet apart, but I understand what you mean and I'm gonna make it work when I do the scene anyway. So they were good about that.
I didn't see it coming together like it did based off what we saw and what we were doing with blocking, which it's that way with any show. The first time you run through blocking and you start setting up stuff, you're like, how is this gonna work? And
so
is this,
a lot of, like, walking in, yeah, in the,
yeah. And it's just, you feel like you're gonna look, you feel like you're just gonna look silly. Like, it's gonna look like a community play, like, mm-hmm, just a bunch of people just doing something. But it came together and it looked great.
I just think because we were in the lobby, I, like, it was just blank to me. Like, I like, you'd give us a prop or like say something was in a specific spot, but because there was no like actual marker, it was a little different in my mind to envision all of the stuff we were going for. So when it slowly started to come together and you'd like roll out a new set piece on the stage once we started working in here, it was so much more magical, I think.
So the fight choreography was particularly challenging because when I was planning it, I had to get a number of everybody who was going to be in it. So I got chess pieces and labeled them with people's names and had them on a giant board going against each other and deciding who was going down and who was getting back up and who was dying. And it was this long, complicated process. And in the end, we just decided to scrap it because we didn't have time to do everything I wanted to do. So we got a few of the plans out of the way, and it did show up in the original, a few of the ideas I wanted. But what ended up happening was, I think you, me, and Rob just came to the theater beforehand, and you would just, before rehearsals every single day, and just block out like individual fights over and over, because there was at least 20 people in that. And people were coming back in and they were falling down and they were switching fighting partners.
One night my wife came home, who was playing one of the Narnians, and she was in a sword fight, and she woke me up. She had a black eye and she said, "I got a black eye, look at this." She was so happy.
The day to day was, we would come in around about 12 o'clock in the afternoon. We would throw together as many different combinations of things that would work, not work, try them out, practice them, record them, watch them back, see what we needed to change. And then we would implement that, move on to the next one. It'd get to about 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, stop, try and teach that to somebody later on in the afternoon. Then we would go back and rehearse the same thing, do the same thing each day afterwards for about a week and a half, 2 weeks. And we were just creating at the time, fight scenes from the top of our head, what we thought would look cool, which wouldn't diminish anything too much from other people, but would ultimately kind of present a big battle that would look authentic enough to have without looking too staged.
Just me and the White Witch fighting, that took a very long time, as you know, to get it just right.
Did you have faith that it was gonna come together at first?
I did, just because I love swords, just hitting people. Yeah.
Well, anything with swords hitting each other,
of course, yes.
I'm gonna guide you on timing. The beginner's gonna have to be a little bit more dramatic and slow. So people have lines. Pay attention.
I was not expecting that it would be unlike anything I'd ever seen on stage. And I didn't expect it to have a soundtrack like a movie.
What music production will look like is I'll sit down in our little music studio room that we just kind of renovated. Sit down and I have the script in my hand. And I'm like, okay, scene one. And then I'll have to like speak the dialogue in my head, make sure like it's gonna be said in the way that I think the actors are gonna say it, time it out. And then kind of think, okay, so Christian, it needs to be like sad, like in this part, or maybe I'll show him like a song that reminds me of what I want it to be. I'm like, listen to this for inspiration. It's going to be a little bit like this.
Basically, it started out with a root idea. We came to the computer and we saw what we could do with that root idea and just making little doodles on the piano and different things we could find. But a lot of times that didn't really work out, so we had to go other places and find some inspiration and kind of not just for how things sounded, but we had to go and listen to different tracks and try to grab that same emotion from those songs to try to match that in our tracks. So it started out with that. Then we moved on to just basic, the basic melody with the piano. We usually started out with piano or something like that. And then we built on from there. So we started in sections. So in the first section, we added piano, built on different music for that, and built on more instruments, stacking them. Then we moved on to the second section, maybe a bridge area or something like that. Same thing, started with the piano, then we built instruments on that. Sometimes it varied. But ultimately, we started out with a root melody, and we kind of built on from there.
But it needs to be only 3 seconds long, and then at that point, it needs to get scary. It needs to switch to like the sad part. It's really tedious, really specific. So he was a trooper in listening to me try to explain the scene that he's not actually a part of the. He's not at the theater. He hasn't seen the actors. He hasn't even read the script. It's just me trying to explain what I need from a specific song. And then there wound up being about 23, 20 something tracks in the show. So he does pretty much anything tech related.
So a lot of times we think we have the perfect track and then we take it to the stage and try it out with the actors, and it turns out either the timing or the volume or something like that, some things don't really match up with what the actors are doing on stage, whether it be blocking or their lines or anything like that. So a lot of times we have to come back and edit those things later on.
I loved that the music and the soundtrack that we had was there. It made it feel very immersive, and added that touch of magic. You could really lose yourself in it, kind of like the movie. But it was interesting since it was all timed, and so trying to find some places, you know, being the comic relief, to ad lib, and other places where we're like, oh, we're on the music schedule, we have to say it exactly the same way we've said it every single time.
The music in Narnia in particular did a great job of kind of setting the mood, especially in those moments where you had something really serious happening, like the altar scene.
Right.
Without the music, the altar scene doesn't work as well. When Aslan comes out one of the last times and you get that big push, from that big swell in the music, like that really sets the tone for the scene. So music plays a huge part.
Yeah, and it not being a musical, it really helped it along. Like, you don't have to sing to feel the emotion. That's what musicals do. And straight plays, they're amazing to, you know, show an actor's range, and because you have to carry it the whole time. There's no waiting for the next musical number. But just having that music in the background kind of tricks the audience into really getting invested in the story, because music does have that powerful, magical feel to really kick in those emotions.
And it was pretty awkward when you didn't have it first.
Yes, that too.
Yeah, that kind of kills it too. It breaks the immersion.
Yeah.
So it makes it where it's a little bit disjointed, I feel. Mm-hmm. And so the music really does.
It's like having a rom-com without the laugh track or something.
Yeah, like you
having
can't...
Narnia without the magical soundtrack to go along with it doesn't fit right.
Yeah.
It definitely helped us, I think, as actors kind of like delve into our characters in the scene. Because if there was no music, it was just dead silence and we were all like looking at each other trying not to laugh.
Yeah.
Just like, okay, wake up, please.
Yeah, there was a night where we could not get the thing to start in time, so he was...
I was just...
You were dead for a long time.
Deadmond.
Far too dead long moment of freedom.
Oh my gosh. Deadmond.
I would say my favorite part may have also been the most difficult part, which was the hooves. I liked my pants. The whole furry bottom half here. Because it made the role really challenging. I like roles that make me come out of my shell and do weird things and that are inherently difficult, you know, because of a weird voice or a weird way that you have to move, and I happened to have both of those things for this one, so.
We'll be getting to this point. Later. I'm staring at me like, wow, it's real fun. It's Mr. Tumnus. And then I rip my ear off, and they're like,
what just happened?
So they really are just like high heels without a heel.
Yep. Stay up.
I just Cinderella my way in there. We came up with a much more blue collar way of dealing with my hooves, which was the comment that I get most often from audience members after the show is not about my performance or how in love with the character they are. It's how do you walk in those? And to that I say, carefully. Originally, I was using this stuff on the horns because, you know, it's fairy gum. It's supposed to be used in all prosthetics. Turns out, it works best on stuff that's more latex.
So, I was nervous, of course. You know, I always am. I'm always nervous about auditions. But more so heightened because I had seen the movie. And I came in knowing that I wanted to be Mr. Tumnus. You know, I came in with that hope, So initially, yeah, I did come in feeling nervous, having had seen the movie. But it got easier very, very quickly because I remembered one of the little kids that auditioned that didn't get cast. When I walked in, they saw me and they said, "Mr. Dumbness?" And at that point, I was okay. At that point, I felt much better.
Jumps out at me, I'm scared on the outside, but on the inside I'm like, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen in my life. A puppet right in my face.
Thomas?
Who are you?
It was a nightmare. The wolf was a nightmare to create. I went through many, many rough drafts. The way it ended up being puppeteered was not at all the way I originally wanted it to be puppeteered. I had made the entire thing out of essentially metal and rivets. And then I covered that with this like papier-mâché mesh, which just added a bunch of weight to it. So it was far too heavy for him. So we had to essentially have him straddle it and hold it from above. And it made the legs much closer to the ground. And we had to work, because the legs kept getting stuck, and I had to work out ways to prevent it from getting stuck, and it still got stuck some of the time. And I had to find a way to keep the legs from slipping, the back legs from slipping down his pant leg.
And speaking of puppeteers, I want to give a shout out to Mr. and Mrs. Beaver.
My favorite parts was being able to do a comedic role, like, and playing off of another character, because I've played characters before. Since I've been doing this for a while, I have played characters that have a name or like a character that you have to become, but it was fun being the comic relief, particularly in the serious storyline of Narnia, and being able to play off another character with a great sense of humor.
However, it wasn't just the fact that they were there. Matt, I cast him because he has perfect comedic timing.
Now, the only note I really remember is just working on the accent. I think I had a little bit of one-on-one attention with that accent, and it worked. It was passable there towards the end, but boy, that was a process.
Mrs. Beaver, I found them. May I present the two sons of Adam and the two daughters of Eve?
He will say this too. His accent was not the best, not when he auditioned or anything. But again, I knew he could get to somewhere that sounded still good, but I just valued his comedic timing so much. When Matt was doing something funny, she was right on top of him with it, and they bounced off each other.
Playing off of Daphne and the whole Mr. and Mrs. Beaver back and forth was always a lot of fun.
That
I really enjoyed doing it.
That opening scene was the best.
Yeah, that opening scene was fantastic.
Oh dear, I'm afraid my sewing machine is too heavy to take along.
Oh no, we'll be up for all the new frocks we're gonna sew on the way there.
Come on!
I'm really glad that they were my beavers. My mom built them entirely by herself. My dad stepped in a few times to do a few little things, but she sculpted both of the faces by herself. She found out a way to make the bodies look match the face. I was really particular with how I wanted the beavers to be. So I knew Aslan was gonna look like he was made out of tree bark and have leaves. And so I kind of wanted to stay on brand with that. I kind of wanted all the puppets to be like they were made out of nature. I looked up pictures of statues of beavers. And I had like these two photos of some random beaver statues from Google that I loved because they had these cute, friendly faces, but it wasn't like fuzzy fur. It was like very sculpted, molded out little fur pieces. And it was very specific in the way that I wanted them. And she delivered. So my mom came up with this idea to get a shag carpet. And she stiffened the shag carpet to where it was piecey, sort of like the pieciness of the clay that she was molding on the body. She had the idea to use the carpet, make it piecey, and cut a strip of the carpet out to where their hand stuck through the carpet, and that kind of created the illusion that the arm was coming out of the body. What we wound up going with was something based off of the Olaf puppet from the Frozen musical. I think, the closest comparison I could make as far as the functionality of the puppets, beaver puppets. So basically their feet were the beaver feet. That's what we decided, so that they could move easily and still be a convincing beaver.
Because like when we were working in there, we had Daphne and Matt. But when we started working in here, we have Mr. and Mrs. Beaver. Mm-hmm. So it was actually kind of a challenge.
Yeah. It was a last minute change.
Yeah, to go from like looking at them to looking about right here. Mm-hmm. And interacting with them instead of them, mm-hmm. I guess.
I keep harping on about the lion puppets and the other puppets and the fight choreo, but those were hard, but everything in this play was hard, I would say. Little things were hard. Like, I kept getting hung up on things you wouldn't think would be a problem, but they wound up being. Like, I could not find a wig and a beard for Father Christmas that didn't look really, really fake and crappy for a reasonable price. I searched for hours online for a beard and hair for Father Christmas that did not cost a fortune, that looked okay.
The most challenging part, believe it or not, was putting on the makeup. The whiskers and all that. Corinne, the girl that did my makeup, would spend about an hour putting on that beard and making sure it was perfect. And so that was the most difficult part. Also, I had a director that wanted me to smile while I was handing out weapons of war to children. So I always thought that was a little difficult to achieve on stage. I've always not wanted to be Father Christmas. People ask me all the time, don't you want to play Father? No. Could you come over to our house and be Father? No.
But this Father Christmas was like different than...
This Father Christmas was I don't know how to explain it. It was enormous. You would swell. I would swell with pride that I was Father Christmas, and it was really cool. He was a badass, but I mean, he was handing out weapons of war to children. I thought, anyway, I know. It was just really, really cool.
My favorite part was probably getting to be evil and yell at people, because I'm not used to doing that. Like, that is not me at all. And so I wouldn't say like, it was fun because it was different, and it's not something that I am used to doing like as a person. So it was a nice like step out of my comfort zone that I ended up really enjoying.
He might not think so, Dad boys.
Then how dare you come alone? Did I not tell you to bring the others with you?
So I got told I was gonna have the shoes, and I was very like interested. So I didn't know they were gonna be as big as they were, and then Sarah told me, she was like, hey, your shoes are here, and I got my shoes, and they're like this.
I think they were at least 8 inches.
I think they were 9, yeah. is what we said. And it took me about 2 weeks to learn how to walk in them, and I was walking in them like everywhere during rehearsal. And I would still trip on them during the show. Like I sprained my ankle. Like I found out after the show I had sprained my ankle, and that was not fun. But it was fun at the time because I got to be taller than everyone else.
Now the great cat.
We were selling, I think the first, I don't remember exactly the numbers, but the first few days, we were already up to 300 or 400 tickets sold. And it was incredible. We've never, ever had that before.
For straight plays.
And almost for anything, we haven't had that them go that quick. So the community, all of a sudden, after 3 days, we were going, wow, they're gonna love this. What our general rule is, once we sell 100 tickets the first weekend, we wanna start thinking about, we're gonna have to add shows. And we hit the 100 ticket mark within the first 6 hours or 7 hours of ticket sales. It was incredible. It was really record setting here at Perry Players. I remember that we thought that's a huge thing to try to do, you know. We knew it was a huge show. We also knew if anybody could pull it off, Hanna and her family could. So I didn't really know what to expect as far as props or the special effects, because I know I'd seen the movie and I didn't know how in the world you could recreate that on stage, but you actually did. It worked out really good. We were very happy, but at the beginning we were wondering, how is that all gonna come to be?
The toll that it took on me was unlike any other show I'd done, and I keep on kind of harping on about that, but I'm pretty sure it screwed up my sleep schedule till today. For reference, the show has been done for months. I think I still can't sleep correctly because of the hours that I put in at the time. Not just me though, Levi and Rob in particular, they stayed up many a nights programming lights with me or building stuff with me or choreographing with me. They saw a switch in me occur during this production in particular. I've done two very difficult shows in the past, but something about this one, something about the time strain, something about the cast that I was handling and the difficulty of communication and so many things.
We stayed here countless nights, just not sleeping. She's a workhorse. She's better than me at it. I get sleepy. I get tired very easily, but she went days without sleep in the last few days.
So there was this one night where we stayed up till 4:15 in the morning, and
yes.
We were all crying the next day. Actually, I had an awful day at school because of it, because I pretty much stayed up all night and I went straight to school. But it was okay, because if that didn't happen, then that track wouldn't have turned out as good as it did. And that was a good school sacrifice there. But you should always put school first.
There were a lot of people putting in tremendous hours and going the extra 92 miles to make this a fantastic experience. It was a lark for me. It was no work at all.
The most challenging thing for me was, you know, we kind of got into the theater late in comparison to most shows. And so with that, there were a lot of like, it was kind of a slow going process as far as like, you know, being able to move certain set pieces out, you know, like, cause maybe we didn't have it yet or something like that, or maybe it wasn't finished.
Jace, your butt flaps weird. Sort it out. I'm just saying. I'm doing it for you. It's love.
It was the extra work I ended up doing, I think, in it, because the time frame was so short, and then there was eventually issues of getting certain things done. One of the last things near the end was getting the lighting sorted out. And so within a week, I had to learn the lighting system, and then we had to choreograph the entire lighting for the show with about 3 days left. And we did it.
I hope you know that this I'm never gonna be able to. This show is gonna be special to me, because I haven't loved anything like Narnia. So, you were part of my heart. Let's just do this.
To the right.
Bring it back now, y'all. One hop this time.
Oh my God, please stop.
One hop this time.
May the circle be unbroken by and by.
Song is it's cool. Was it the last one though that I think Philip was filming?
Yeah.
I liked that one in particular a lot, because that one felt more like a final
circle. Yeah, you can feel it.
I bet I was sobbing in the footage.
I just really like how theater takes a bunch of different people and has them work together despite whatever's going on in their life or at that time or anything. And so Circle just kind of, you know, helps enforce that we're all on the same team and we're gonna put on a good show.
I love it. No, wait a minute. No. I love it because in one time, in one instance, the whole cast is together. They're all in sync. I absolutely love Circle Time. Now, well, I will tell you this. In 2015, when I did my first show here, I didn't even know what the heck was going on. I said, what is this? What are they kumbaya singing? I find it very, very important. It's a time you can just sit there and say the words, but you get to look at every one of your cast members and you're getting in the zone. No, I love it.
I think the thing for me that kind of sticks for that particular moment is that's the only time everybody's together. Mm-hmm. Because any other time during a show, there's somebody on stage, there's somebody moving set, there's somebody backstage, and that's the time when you can look around the circle and these are the people that you're going to be doing this with. And it kind of gives you a moment to kind of focus and get your head right and an opportunity to kind of take a breath before the plunge, so to speak, quote Tolkien.
Yeah.
I love that. That's one of the things I really enjoy about the process here at Perry Players.
Hit it all the way around. Break a leg.
Break a leg.
Break a leg.
Five-year-old Hannah wanted to first start doing acting and doing theater. It was because of Narnia. It was because she wanted to find out how she could experience magic. The magic like that was in Narnia. What I learned was that theater was the closest thing you could get to magic. Theater is arguably the closest thing you can get to magic. And one of the magical things about theater is that once it's done, it's gone forever. It's literally just there in your memory. It's not recorded normally. And you will never have the same group of people with the same group of things ever again. So what I'm hoping is that with this documentary, we might make a new type of magic for Perry Players Theater.
Lucy and Chris Kemp come out onto stage. They're going to hate you. So thank you. That was your bouquet. Yeah. Got it? Okay. Lucy made the puppet, the beavers, the dam, the wall behind it's painted. Chris built Aslan. He built Aslan. Is the infamous director, Hanna Kemp. Hanna worked tirelessly to make this happen. 3.5 weeks we had in the theatre to put everything together. I kid you not when I tell you, she had about 2 hours sleep most nights leading up to this. She looked crazed by the end of it. But her dedication to bring this vision to life is second to none. This has been something she's wanted to do for so long, and you've managed to see it now. And I don't think you'll see anything quite like this again. I mean, look at me. I look phenomenal. So, if you're a guest, please stand for me quickly and give the biggest cheer and the biggest smile. Time for the cast.
Might have been the scariest noise I've ever made.